All right, let's break down one of the biggest ideas in economics, but we're going to do it with a simple story about survival. It's all about making tough choices when you just can't have everything. Let's get right into it. So, picture this. You're stranded. Desert island. You've got 12 hours of sunlight to get your act together and survive. You've only got so much time, so much energy. This isn't just a survival game. It's literally the core problem of all economics. We want everything, but our resources are limited. So, what do you do? How do you choose?
So let's put a face to this problem. Meet Moshe. He's our survivor, he's all alone, and he is facing this exact dilemma. He needs to eat, but time? Well, time is ticking. This is his reality.
Okay, so here's the number one rule of this game, the biggest constraint, the clock. Moshe has 12 hours. That's it, not an end more. This single limit is going to shape every single decision he makes from here on out.
For every hour that goes by, Moshe has two basic choices. He can spend that hour fishing, and if he does, he'll catch two fish. Or he could spend it gathering coconuts and get four of them. The key thing? He can't do both at the same time. This is the trade-off. Every hour he's out trying to catch fish is an hour he's not under the trees getting coconuts. You see the dilemma here?
Now, you could try to juggle all these different combos in your head, but that gets complicated really fast. So let's do what economists do. Let's draw a picture. A simple graph can help us map out every single possible outcome for Moshe's day. We're going to set up our graph like this, super simple. The vertical axis, the one going up and down, that's for fish. The horizontal axis, going side to side, that's for coconuts. And just like that, we have a canvas to lay out his entire world of possibilities.
So let's start with the extremes, because that's always the easiest place to begin. What if Moshe decides to just go all in on fishing? He spends all 12 of his hours at the water. How many fish does he end up with?
Yep, 24. The math is easy enough, right? 12 hours times 2 fish an hour. But, and this is key, that means he gets 0 coconuts. So let's pop our first point onto the graph, way up at 24 on the fish axis and sitting at 0 on the coconut axis.
Okay, now for the flip side. What if he totally ignores the water, forgets fishing even exists, and dedicates his entire 12-hour day to coconuts? What's his grand total then?
He'd have a whopping 48 coconuts. That's 12 hours times 4 coconuts every hour. This gives us our second major point on the graph, this time 0 fish and all the way out at 48 on the coconut axis.
But you know, life is rarely all or nothing, right? Moshe doesn't have to go all in. He can totally mix it up. So what if he just splits his day right down the middle? 6 hours fishing gets him 12 fish, and the other 6 hours gets him 24 coconuts. And there we go. Another possible combo, a point right in between our two extremes.
Okay, so this is where the magic happens. We've got these three dots on our graph. All fish, all coconuts, and the 50-50 split. They show us a few ways Moshe can spend his day. But what happens when we connect them and see all the possibilities?
And that line, my friends, has a name. It's called the Production Possibility Frontier, or PPF for short. Think of it as a map of every single combination of fish and coconuts Moshe can possibly produce if he uses all 12 of his hours with perfect efficiency. Any point on this line is a good, productive day.
So let's be super clear about what it means to be on the line. Every single point on that PPF tells us it's not only possible to produce, but it's also efficient. Efficient just means no wasted time. It doesn't matter if he picks the combo with 24 fish and no coconuts, or the one with 12 fish and 24 coconuts, as long as he's on that line, he has put in a full 12-hour day.
Okay, so we know what the line means, but what about all that other empty space on the graph? I'm talking about the area inside the line, and maybe even the area outside it. Turns out, those spaces have a really important meaning too.
Let's try a little thought experiment. Let's say Moshe wraps up his day, counts his haul, and he's got 12 fish and 20 coconuts. So where's that point on our graph? Is he on that line of efficiency? Think about it for a second.
Let's do the math. To get those 12 fish, we know that takes him 6 hours. Okay. And to get 20 coconuts at 4 per hour, that takes 5 hours. Wait a minute. 6 plus 5 is 11. He only worked for 11 hours. He had a 12-hour day. He must have taken an hour-long nap or something. He wasted a whole hour. That point is inside our frontier.
And in the world of economics, when you have resources that could be working but aren't, we have a word for that, unemployment. For Moshe, the unemployed resource was an hour of his own labor. So any point inside that production possibility frontier represents inefficiency.
It represents a state of unemployment.
All right, so we've covered the line. That's efficient. Inside the line, that's inefficient. So what about the last zone? What about trying to produce something outside the frontier? Is that even possible for Moshe?
And the answer is, nope, can't be done. Think of the frontier as a hard wall. It is the absolute maximum he can produce with the resources he has, which, in this case, is his 12 hours of work. Anything beyond that line is, for now, just a fantasy.
So let's just nail this down. We've basically mapped out three distinct zones. If you're on the frontier, you're being efficient, and it's possible. If you're inside the frontier, it's still possible, but you're being inefficient. That's unemployment. And if you're outside the frontier, that's just plain impossible.
But this brings up a really great question. If every single point on that line is perfectly efficient, which one should he pick? Which one is the best? And the truth is, the graph can't tell you. That's not a math problem. That's a lunch problem. It all comes down to preference. Economics can't tell Moshe if he's in the mood for fish or coconuts. It can just show him the most productive ways to get them.
You know, we've built this entire world around just one guy. But what happens to this pretty little line when, all of a sudden, a second person washes up on shore? How does that change the game? Well, that's a question that opens up a whole new world of ideas, like specialization and trade, and it might just change everything.
Thank you.